I finally did it. I bit the bullet and forked over $210 to turn this Game Boy Advance SP into this one, an unhinged model. Was it worth it? Well, stay tuned and find out, because today I'm going to take you through the build process and share with you some of my own thoughts on this premium Game Boy device. If you look at all the early generations of Game Boy devices, you see this slow evolution into what became the Game Boy Advance SP. We started out with this sort of big and clunky device that, while portable, wasn't really better than some of the other options on the market at the time. There was no light, and the screen quality really wasn't great. And as time moved on, we got a smaller footprint and a better screen, and we even got a backlight. We also got better games. But the pinnacle of this era was the Game Boy Advance SP. It was smaller with rechargeable batteries, had a built-in backlight, and played not only the great new Advance games, but also our beloved original Game Boy games. So here's the question then. If this thing is so great, then why spend the time and money to mod it? Well, that's a good question. And I think the answer is, great 20 years ago isn't the same as great today. For example, the SP did introduce a rechargeable battery, which was very much welcome. But the proprietary charging cable was inconvenient. The lighted screen was also great, but it really doesn't compare to the IPS technology of today. And perhaps Nintendo was a little ahead of its time when it removed the headphone jack from the SP, which meant that you had to have a separate headphone adapter with you. A minor inconvenience, but it was still something lacking. And fortunately, we have a mod that fixes all of these problems for us and gives us a Game Boy Advance SP for the modern technological age. And I'll confess, I've wanted one of these ever since I first laid eyes on it a couple of years ago. This is the Unhinged mod by Boxy Pixel. They've taken the SP, removed the hinge, and replaced it with this gorgeous aluminum shell. And it's not required, but you also have the option of dropping in one of those nice IPS displays that I used in my other Game Boy Advance SP a couple of months ago. And if you watched that video, you saw how power-hungry that display was when I measured its current draw. So, what better mod to couple with it than a 1700 milliamp hour battery? If you do the math, then that means at the average brightness setting, you're going to be able to play this modded Game Boy for 10 or more hours between charges. And when you're ready to feed it some juice, there's no longer a need to search out your Game Boy charging cable, because the Unhinged can add an optional USB-C charging port to your Game Boy Advance SP, perfect for minimizing the cables you need to bring with you when traveling. Oh, and what else would be perfect for traveling? How about a headphone jack? Yeah, I'd say if you're a Game Boy enthusiast, then you're probably drooling over what I just showed you. But you haven't seen the price yet. Let me break it down for you. Now, there's several pieces that you need. First, the aluminum shell. That's $95. The aluminum buttons, $21. Optional aluminum shoulder buttons, $18. If you want the IPS display, that's $58. $9.99 for the battery. Surprisingly, only $2 for the USB-C charging board. $3.50 for the headphone jack. And $2.50 for the LED diffuser. And all this adds up to a whopping $209.99 before taxes and shipping. Oh, and of course, you need a Game Boy Advance SP. Look, I'm not saying it's not a fair deal. Far from it. I mean, these are high quality machined aluminum parts. In this case, you're getting what you're paying for. But you just need to be aware that this is not an inexpensive mod. When it arrived, I was super excited to dig in. So let's go through the assembly process together. Okay, wait a minute. Time out. Before we go into the assembly footage, I have to let you know that this was a really frustrating build. You're about to see a simplified version of this process, but in reality, I had to back up and redo some of these steps a lot. Okay, let's get going. The first thing I had to do was remove the main board from the original Game Boy. And we can't forget the speaker. I then used some flush cutters to trim the solder joints near the LCD ribbon cable. And then I covered them with some Kapton tape. Now this is to prevent these from poking into the cable. Next, I inserted the LED diffuser into the holes. After that, I placed the buttons into the shell. And then I soldered the wires onto the USB-C charging board. Now the instructions said to do this after mounting the board into the shell, but I thought it would be easier to do when it was outside of the housing. And I just used a little bit of VHB tape to mount it to the inside of the shell. And then soldered the wires to the connector. Next, I did the same thing for the headphone port. There were four wires on that needed to be connected. I used a little bit of hot glue to adhere it to the inside of the shell before soldering its wires to the connector. And it did get a little cramped over there, so I double-checked to make sure that I wasn't bridging any pins. The next thing is to wire in the new LCD. This wire enables you to use the light button to control the brightness and other settings in the LCD. After this, I screwed down the mainboard to hold it in place for soldering in the battery connector. And then it was time to lock the LCD into place. Now, the instructions recommended putting some foam padding behind the LCD, but when I tried to add some, it made it too tight of a fit, so I ended up leaving that out. Next is to install the backplate, and before putting it in place, I needed to move over the cartridge slot shield from the old housing. And of course, install the new shoulder buttons. And the new power switch. Now, I did have to fidget with the cover quite a bit to get everything to line up, but it did eventually fit together well. Finally, I connected the battery and installed the battery cover. Now, I'm not going to show you the whole ordeal here, but it took me probably 20 minutes of finagling to get the battery to fit in well enough to attach the back cover. This was just one of the many frustrations I experienced when I was going through this build. And thankfully, it seemed to fire up without a problem the first time. Okay, well, I think we're done. I played with the device for a few days after the initial build, and I felt that the travel on the A and B buttons just felt a little too shallow. So I still went back in again, disassembled it, rerouted some wires, and reassembled it. Now, the good news is that right now, it feels pretty good, but it did take a lot of finagling to get there. Now, the screen looks good, which is what I would expect because it's the same screen that I used in my other SP mod. But notice that this screen does not have the logo at the bottom, which I thought was interesting. I actually think it looks kind of neat without it. Oh, and check this out. I actually missed this in my other SP screen upgrade video and encountered it completely by accident here. If you hold down this middle button here, you get an on-screen display where you can cycle through the various options. I wasn't sure what FRM meant, but after doing some research, the best I can tell is it's a frame blending option. I'm not sure what it does though, I don't really notice any difference when it's on. I can't deny it, the device is absolutely beautiful, there is no doubt about that. And as I mentioned before, the parts are really high quality. But despite all that, there are a couple of things that I don't really like. First, the battery. I love the fact that it's 1700 milliamp hours, but it doesn't quite fit when using that white connector. Now, if I clipped it off and soldered the battery directly to the board, then I'm sure it would fit perfectly. But really what we need is just a couple extra millimeters of space here. I jammed it in there, but I'm not feeling great about it. Another thing that I really wasn't thrilled about was the wire routing. I used magnet wire like the instructions recommended, but it all barely fits together. And I still had to take it apart, move wires, and reassemble it 5 times before everything felt right. If you're not installing the headphone jack, this will be less of a problem for you, but man, everything's just a tight fit in there. The last thing I'm not loving is the shoulder buttons. I bought the aluminum ones, which means I can't put the springs from the original SP buttons in. While they do work, there's not a lot of travel, and they don't really have the feeling of springing back like the original buttons do. They do look great, but I'm actually thinking about removing them and sticking in the plastic ones. Now, aside from those complaints, there are many things which I absolutely love, which you can't do with the original shell. The biggest is undoubtedly the USB-C port for charging. I just love not having to tote around that special Nintendo charging cable. I have USB-C cords all over my house, so whether I'm playing it in the bedroom, living room, or even in the shop, there's always a place to charge the battery. Another thing that I really love about it is that it addresses one of my biggest complaints about this upgraded screen, and that's the battery life. This large capacity battery means that I'm going to be able to enjoy playing for several hours before I need to pull out that USB-C cable. Okay, before I wrap up, there's one more thing that I think we need to do. A beautiful device like this needs to be on display. So I went into Fusion 360 and made a display stand for it. I set it back at a 10 degree angle and contoured the holder to closely match the unhinged shell. This makes it a nice snug fit so your device doesn't slip out. After a couple of quick test runs, I printed the final model with 200 micron layers using one of my favorite PETG filaments, Crucimint Chalky Blue. And about 2.5 hours later, it was all done and ready to proudly display the gorgeous unhinged Gameboy Advance SP. Now, if you want one of these display stands, I posted this model over at printables.com. There's a link in the description, so you can go print your own if you want. So at the end of the day, the question is, would I recommend this? I don't know. If you have $200 burning a hole in your pocket, then I could think of worse ways to spend it. But for the cost-conscious classic gamer, perhaps just the $50 IPS screen upgrade would be a better deal. I mean, you could always do the screen upgrade, and then if you decided to upgrade to the aluminum unhinged model later, then you can drop in the new screen and upgrade just the shell. I do find it difficult to advise anyone against an upgrade if you really want it. We all want different things for different reasons. But one warning I'll give you is if you're going to go this route, And if you're going to do the headphone jack in particular, make sure you're pretty comfortable with the soldering iron. It's very easy to bridge pins in that connector you solder the headphone jack wires to, so be ready with some desoldering wick to clean up your work. One other thing I'll mention here as we wrap up is that I did find that the device became a bit uncomfortable to hold after playing it for 20 or 30 minutes. Now, it might just be the way I hold my handheld devices, but I tend to rest the bottom side on my pinkies. And after doing this for a while, the hard edges of the shell start to irritate them. Others may not have this problem, but I did find it to be an issue for me. Thanks for joining me in this look at the Gameboy Advance SP Unhinged mod by Boxy Pixel. Now, despite some of my complaints, I really do love this mod, and I have a feeling that this is going to continue to be the main Game Boy that I play on. Now, if you want to pick up one of these for yourself, you'll find the link to Boxy Pixel storefront in this video's description. And if you've already done this mod yourself, please share your experiences in the comments below. I'll be really curious to see if anyone else encountered some of the same things that I did. And if you have any suggestions for other Game Boy or other portable device mods that you want to see me cover, please leave a comment on that as well. All right, that's it for today. I'll see you next time. But until then, go make or mod something cool.